Well, I'm just reporting here from one of the more amazing experiences I've ever had, and it was so amazing on many, many levels. One, I was pre-warned about it. Absolutely 100% sure, pre-warned about it. About a half an hour before it took place. Looking back, this event took place. I said, "That is really weird." I got mad about it. What? And I said, "No, this is something important." Then looking back, I said, "Oh, I was totally pre-warned." And lastly, I was shown complete assurance that the Dharma kings, especially Longchenpa, had my back the whole time. This was indicated to me. And in the middle, I went through this, like, one of the worst faux pas imaginable. And I emerged from it completely unscathed. It was just amazing. The potential for trouble was just enormous. Enormous. And yet it was like I was invisible. Came through it totally unscathed, like I was invisible. And was warned about it ahead of time. I just said, "Wow, isn't this amazing?" Super wow. Super wow situation where I cannot talk about particulars that could put me in some jeopardy even now. But it just it drove home the point that there's a big mess coming in the world, and you might think that you can't help out. And I actually fled. It was amazing. I first I didn't help out, and then I turned back. I said, "No, I got to." Some friends reminded me, "Gotta help." So I did. I thought, "I'm gonna get in so much trouble." Wow. Nothing happened. Nothing. I said, "How's that possible?" Dharma King was there and showed me that's how it's possible. So we can. A big mess is coming in the world, and the. We think that if we try to help out, we're going to get clobbered. But we won't. We won't. The Dharma kings have our backs. And it's like they're able to put like a cloak of invisibility around us, so to speak, where we just can do no wrong. I mean, nobody. Everything works out fine for us. And I'm driving down the road, I'm shaking like, "Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? You kidding me? I'm okay. I'm okay. I'm okay." I'm a little paranoid now still. It's like nothing's gonna happen to me. No. So this is the pressure runner right now, and we might be under pressure to run away from the whole situation. I was certainly saying, "The heck with it. Let me just run away from it. If I go back and deal with some situation, I'm gonna get in just a immeasurable trouble. I'm really going to be in so much trouble." But I had to do it, and I said, "Wow." So you may be feeling the same pressure like me, like I just got to run away from this. But no. Stick with it. Go back, help out, and nothing will happen to you. The unrepentant ones that will fine you $1,000 just to keep for nothing, just to make keep you in line to make sure that they can remind you that they can do it. If they do, they have the power to do it. We think they're just going to absolutely devastate us. The New World Order people, Machiavellian New World Order, bureaucratic liberal, feminist reptilian complex, the whole arrogant complex that believes that the answer comes from just more and more regulation of everything and severe penalties. Everyone's got to be kept in line like a robot. They've all become robotic, the robotic people. We think they're just going to, have the power to devastate us, but not when the Dharma kings have your back. And I was able to like move very, very, very quick and nimble and agile and athletic. I was able to do everything just like boom, 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 boom. So I had the strength to do everything. And it's just, so I say, be in great spiritual shape. Be in good physical shape too, but great spiritual shape right now. What's this? I don't know, something. Because there are issues coming. Another amazing thing happened to me today. Again, people just volunteered this, their personal experience. And I was like, wow, that's amazing. I don't know exactly what's going to happen. The Dharma Kings do, though. You better believe they do. But it's a big mess. A really big mess. Unexpected mess. Like, are you kidding me? It's something that we just don't think could happen. But it will happen. I don't want people freaking out or speculating too much or anything. You just have to keep working out. Just keep getting in shape better and better and better and better. Now, if you have the wow situation, which the progress is so rapid now, the wow might be very strong. Just go to Darshan, Satsang. Keep Satsang. I went to this Facebook page of Sri Ma Anandamayi. And today, and right on the top, on their newsfeed timeline, the picture was, it says, had a picture of her and said, keep Satsang. And I said, wow. That's exactly what I needed to hear. Under all circumstances, keep Satsang. Let absolutely nothing prevent you from keeping Satsang. Doesn't matter what it is. And there's different ways you could do that. I just have liked these various pages, Sri Sargadatta Maharaj page, Ramaharshi page. I've liked these various pages, and then they're going to show up in my newsfeed. I didn't realize you could do that. So just go to your Facebook page, and all the posts, the latest posts from these great websites will be there. And you can have your own darshan, your own satsang, just like that. And that's a nice break from working too hard or trying to figure everything out. You know, it's so you have to find ways to stay with your satsang, which is, you know, hearing the truth, viewing the truth, being in the presence of truth, staying focused on it. You have to stay focused on it right now. Have to. So I'm going to put some links so you can get to these Facebook pages. Most people spend their time on Facebook anyway. So it's easy. You're on Facebook, you look at your newsfeed, you like these pages, you prioritize them, see this first. You can go to your settings, preferences, and prioritize, and you click on them as it says, you know, see first, put at the top of my timeline. You can do that, you can prioritize them. And just on your smartphone or, you know, your computer, just always be paying attention to these news feeds. I mean, they're doing a great job. The Ramaharshi Facebook pages is just awesome, the job they do. And Sri Sri Ma Anandamayi, they're doing a really good job. There's another site that also does a good job. And then Sri Sargadatta Maharaj, I just found that today. We'll see how that goes. It looks like they're posting a lot on that too. This is like super helpful. Super helpful. Because they're non-dualists. The advice they give is just, the whole vibe is just, you're getting transmissions from them, whether you know it or not. And you don't have to, when the fruit is ripe, it'll fall. You don't have to explain how it fell. Just say it's the grace of the guru. That's all. And you say, maybe I'll dig into it later a little more, but not right now. I'm just going to put it down to the grace of guru for now, because I'm so active, I cannot afford to dig into all this stuff. But the bottom line, the fruit was ripe and it fell. Okay, it means you're feeling intrinsic spaciousness. That's when the fruit falls, you feel intrinsic spaciousness. You feel it. It's like everything is just floating like a cloud in the sky. There's this feeling to it all. It's a blissful feeling. But The ego will say, well, how did it happen? Because it wants to make sure to avoid it. And you can just say, well, you know, that it as far as I know, is the grace of the guru. The guru decided, the guru, grace of God, grace of the guru, it took care of it for me. And that's what I'm saying now. And later, I may look at it more closely, but I don't feel it's the right time to try and be, you know, trying to look back at this point. You know, the fruit fell, and that's what's important. It was important is to ripen the fruit. And there's an example that when you ripen the fruit, it will fall. And it doesn't matter what caused it to fall, because what caused it to fall is all your spiritual practice. The ripening of it caused it to fall. That's the bottom line, right? Of course, the ego wants to avoid any practice or any ripening or falling. It says, yeah, but I want to practice, but I don't want it to fall, you know, that kind of thing. Well, that's the ego. Of course you want the fruit to fall. When you're ready, it falls. How do you get ready? 360-degree practice, continual wowing your grace that arises. Just wow the grace that arises. I was singing great today. Yesterday was horrible. Today it was just great. It's just amazing. Wow, I was on fire today. I was dancing. Some guy comes by with his salsa music on, and I just start dancing. He goes, yeah, all right. And I had everybody's back today. It's amazing. People are getting surgery. They're having problems. They had car accidents, everything, broken arms, all sorts of stuff. My friends, I'm saying, hey, I got your back, man. You know, keep your chin up, you know. So I had super positive energy today, super positive. And just singing the heck out of songs. Changing the way the song, you know, doing it, making it better, or at least as good, and not just following along. I was just, you know, had my voice. So what a day. It was a beautiful day today, about 90 degrees probably here. We're going to have a week full of 90s here in the Bay Area now, coming up, more than a week actually. It's just a summer, it's descended upon place, but it's not too hot, it's just beautiful. As always, you know, it's just you pinch yourself. Is this a dream? You know, is this real or is it? It's so nice here. So I'm just moving. I was moving today on my feet, just light on my feet. It was like amazing. What happened? I don't know, but it just shows you. You could have an amazing bounce back. Yesterday I was so low, couldn't sing at all. Was tired. You know, it just hadn't slept for two nights. Everything was piling up on me. Today I feel like a world beater. How did that happen? I don't know. So whatever you do, don't give up right now. You could bounce back just the very next day. Suddenly you're on top of the world like that. This is what I'm experiencing. Very, very confident. In fact, I might have even been overconfident. But I think this whole thing was set up for me to see something that showing me you may not think you can function in the world to help out, but you will be able to. Because certainly you would think that you're going to be targeted if you try to go against the status quo, what's coming up in the world. And it could be a whopper. It's likely to be an absolute whopper what happens. And many already know, have a pretty good intuition of what's going to happen, actually. They really do. And a lot of people are actually on it. A lot. There's a likelihood. The world is really going to be rocked very severely by by various happenings. So we just have to realize that we can help out. We can help out. I was able to deal with the situation. Now, it was a little bit ragged. I mean, but it was good enough, and it was funny. It was just, it was ironic. It was perfect. It was just perfect in how it worked out. So keep trusting your preparation. Keep trusting your workouts. We do spiritual workouts here. This is what it's always been about: spiritual workouts. We're working out. Spiritually working out, like you would do a workout physically, we do the same thing spiritually. We just work out. And what? Guess what? We get stronger. Of course. Of course. How could we not? Start out the day by seeing that there's no realizer of reality at all. There's nothing to realize reality at all. We're waiting for realization to take place. There's no realization to take place. There's no realizer. We can dream of a realizer. Sure, we'll dream of a realizer, but there is really no realizer at all. Nothing outside of reality to return to it. No returner, no realizer. No me to be enlightened. None of that. There's not even a me to be enlightened. Consider that. Not even a me to be enlightened. Not even a false self to be enlightened. When the fruit is ripe, it will simply fall. That's all. Just trust it. Keep ripening the fruit. Keep ripening the fruit. And when you're tired in one way, go to another. Like in physical exercise, you know, if you're worn out in one area, work on an area that you're not worn out in. So if you're tired of one type of spiritual exercise, go to another type. Do some graphics. Listen to some spiritual music. Always stay engaged. Use your brilliance and the Holy Spirit's grace to help you stay engaged, which is satsang. Engagement with truth is satsang. Stay engaged with it 24/7. Stay engaged with it 24/7. And just like I was saying, jogging, we're walking, we're plodding along. We think, oh, you know, I'm tired of plodding along, walking like a zombie. Maybe I'll just stop and sit. No. Skip along, hop along, dance along, boogie along, boogaloo along, boogaloo down Broadway. Snap your fingers along, you know, so change the way you're going along the path a little bit. Put a little hop, skip, and a jump into it. Hop, skip, and a jump. Hop, skip, and a jump. Hop, skip, and a jump. I had to use my agility today. It's like a workout. Wow. It's like a cat. Very agile. I said, wow. Look at that agile. I've had a couple things like this the last couple months where I had to emergency use my conditioning. And I surprised myself. I said, wow, I'm in better condition than I realized. So when an emergency arises, I can move like lightning. But still calm and properly assessing stuff too at the same time. So I'm not panicking. You know, I'm pretty confident. I think I can handle this. I feel confident I can. So I don't try to show off. Just stay intelligent, you know, wise at the same time. This is very important. So what's today? The 22nd, I think. 23rd. Oh my gosh. By the time you read this, hear this, it'll be the 24th. That means it's just 1 month away. And this is probably why I had this situation happen today. It was showing me a major, major, super unexpected, hasn't happened yet, you know, in history sort of thing. Something's going to happen that it's just, say, are you kidding me? This is a disaster. This is terrible. This is too much. I can't deal with it. You know, it's going to be like that. I'll tell you this, the Tibetans have our back. The wow. Longchenpa and crew are on the scene. And they got the heavy machinery out for this one. They have very, very, of course, tuned in to various things that can happen. And so they're most likely extremely aware of what's going to happen. They're able to see the future by reading intentions. They're so amazing. The Dharma kings are so amazing. They know what's going to happen ahead of time. And so they're confident that they can help out. They have the capacity. They definitely have the capacity to help out. And they will. And they will. What good is all this capacity they have if they don't use it? Of course they'll use it. One month. We have 1 month now. We have 1 month. 30 days. Maybe even 29 now. I mean, but we'll call it 30. We want to be ready by the 24th of July. Does this give us a little wiggle room? Maybe a couple days. I don't know. Maybe not. Maybe not. We want to be ready by the 24th of July. We want to be in really good spiritual condition. So we should put ourselves through a work, final workouts. Really, I've got some things I want to work out on, just to make sure that I'm there. I want to run a 10-minute course. I want to, there are certain goals that kind of indicate that, I'm in really, really great shape. So I'm gonna try that one of these days pretty soon, probably. Just see, how fast can I run for 10 minutes? Can I really, just. That has to do, running has to do with your whole body, actually. Everything does. Your core is so important. Keeps your balance, keeps everything smooth and effortless, kind of minimizes the effort. Your arms, your upper body, it's just something about just your overall strength is helps in every way possible. Same thing with spirituality. It's a 360-degree thing. You might not think that working out your ankles is important, but you know what? It is. The only thing that's not important, maybe you don't want to work out your earlobes, that's not too helpful. But the ankles, sure. So every way we can strengthen ourselves spiritually, we should do that, and you begin to feel overall strength. That shows up in a crisis, an emergency. It just shows up. It's there. And you say, I said, I can do this. Not a problem. So, here's the deal. Err on the side of caution. The world needs those people who are cautious and take precautions and say, you know what, it's possible there could be quite a bit of trouble. So let me be ready for that. Most people are not taking such efforts. They'll say, well, if something bad happens, then I'll react to it. But I don't want to do all this work ahead of time and then have nothing happen. Then I'll waste all my effort. Well, actually not. Because you're getting such good condition that you can deal with any crisis. So it just you become super confident. So how can that be a bad thing? It's not. But most people are lazy. Doubting Thomas is to say, well, I'll wait and see. If something bad happens, okay, then I'll try to deal with it. Probably too late at that point if you haven't prepared ahead of time. But it's good to have, every family should have somebody who's says, you know what? I think the future looks like it could be really a lot of agitation, so I'm going to really work on peace of mind and spiritual fitness so I can help out. Every family should have someone like that in the family. But they don't get it. They think that we all got to be on the same. No, you need to diversify. If everyone in the family is the same, if they get all, something happens, they're all caught flat-footed. It's a disaster for them. Where if someone errs on the side of caution and something happens, they say, yeah, it's okay, I can help out, I'm ready. It's just a no-brainer, really. So if you're one of those who likes to prepare, this is a great thing to do. Don't apologize for it. You might be Johnny on the spot. What can we do? I was looking at pictures of Sri Sri Anandamayi yesterday, all evening and late, till midnight, past midnight. I mean, it was just hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds. I said, well, okay, what good is it? Well, you know what? Dharma kings have transmission capabilities. So you don't know how that's strengthening you. Down, just like when you do some exercise, you may not feel exactly, how did that strengthen me? I don't know. But down the line, you'll find out. I said, oh, wow, I'm glad I did that. Like flexibility and so what, just turning, trying to rotation and stuff. How's that going to help? Well, you might need to suddenly rotate like this quickly, grab something, and suddenly, oh my gosh, I have the strength to do that. 360-degree strength. It's very important, 360-degree strength. Three hundred and sixty degree confidence. Call it super confidence. Now, we think this world has gotten us down. Yeah, but it hasn't defeated us. It hasn't defeated us. Sure, it got me down. Absolutely. It didn't defeat me, though. Because I refused to let it defeat me. I said, no. I'm going to keep my confidence and ride out the storm. So, we're not defeated. We can make a comeback. More and more and more. I'm feeling like I did when I was young. I'm remembering stuff when I like I was young. I said, and it's like I had this, I have having feelings. I said, I haven't felt like this. I haven't had that feeling since I was 12 years old or something. Wow. And I've never just danced to some music. It was out in public, and there's a bunch of people around, and everybody kind of laughed at, yeah, they didn't have any problem with it at all. They said, yeah, I enjoyed it. That's great. And I didn't even know I could do it. I just decided, let me see. I just felt light on my feet. And I just started moving around my feet nimbly. I don't know. I don't even know. And it was just like, it was just go with the flow. It was amazing. It's absolutely astonishing. Never done such a thing. I can't dance at all, but it's just like I was able to move, like floating, he's sort of just floating around. And people, they see that and they'd say, oh, this guy's light on his feet. That's cool. So it's just about being light on your feet. Same thing with attitude. Be light with your attitude. Be full of light with your attitude. Be full of light with your attitude. Be light with your attitude. People say, wow, they really have a light attitude. That's great. Was able to sing the high parts this morning, starting now, but eventually the voice got tired and I couldn't, but I found a way to do it. It's kind of, so I might be able to get back to that later on. I couldn't quite hit the notes, but for a while I was able to do a lot of the higher woo, woo, and it's like, oh my gosh, maybe it's coming back. Why not? Why not? I'll keep trying. Keep trying. We'll keep trying. It's just like working out. You go up and a little down a little bit, then up a little higher, then down a little bit, up a little higher and down. That's just the way it goes, right? It's always that way. If you're a musician, you know exactly what we're talking about here. You might practice, 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 and you think you're getting worse, 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 and then one day you get up and suddenly, wow, you're just zipping along. You say, what? Oh, wow, I guess I'm not getting worse. I'm getting a lot better. And then you play, practice more, and then you start getting a little worse, a little worse, a little worse, keep practicing, and then you think, oh, no, terrible again. And then, you know, a little later, wow, you're just really hitting it. And you say, wow, I'm really improving. It's just exactly like that, except the content is not music. It's dropping your concepts, including the concept of enlightenment. Drop that concept too. Drop the concept of being and non-being. Being is a concept, non-being is a concept. Reality is beyond being and non-being. They say it's inexpressible, completely inexpressible. What a mess I had today. Clean it all up. What a mess. Wow. Out of the blue, you know, just suddenly, you know, unexpectedly. Wow. And this is what we're headed for. Something very unexpected. Although there are those, again, who expect it for sure. And we don't know for sure here. We're not going to speculate too much right now. It's not a time for that. It's a time for practicing and just trusting it. You know, trust in the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit has told me that we're going to get rocked, very severely rocked here. Now, I don't know, you know, is that rocks from the sky, from space, or is that a metaphor for events just, you know, absolutely stunning the world and causing great mental agitation? Or both, right? But we're going to get rocked very severely. One month. So you just keep on with your routine, and just, you know, keep up with it. Today I'm taking a break because I've been hitting it so strongly. It's good to, as far as working out physically, just take a break. Yeah, maybe I'll do a little bit later on. Possible in the evening time. Tomorrow, I hope I can hit it pretty hard, also. And you just keep building up the strength. I'm going to hit the satsang very, very much today. Who knows? I'll be doing graphics, maybe all sorts, and just trying to produce more videos that are, full of beauty and transmission, grace, the grace of transmission, of inherent spaciousness. We can feel everything as if it were just transparently floating in inherent spaciousness. We can just shift our attention that way easily, actually. And people will say, "Well, how did you do it?" As soon as you start thinking how you did it, you're out of it. So you can just say, "It's just, the guru's grace did it for me. It's just a matter of the guru's grace." In other words, it's an inscrutable, inscrutable how it happens, and yet it does happen. So for those who prepare, it does. You can take it to the bank. It doesn't matter how, how we describe how it happened. It's the happening is there, regardless of any description, and it's probably best not to struggle with any description initially at all, because that's not going to help anyone do it. It's just all the practicing, the ripening is what's important. The ripening finally reaches the stem, and that's when it falls. So when it reaches the stem, it reaches the stem, but you'll be ready by that time anyway. So we don't need to get ahead of ourselves. So just sitting quietly is super helpful, actually. Don't have to have any other goal. And don't try to reach that goal, but just do it. Just be it. Just be it. Sometimes the best work is just sitting quietly. Don't rush off in any direction. So we're not pursuing anything. Existence is just the insane pursuit of spiritual blindness, actually. That's all it is. The insane pursuit of spiritual blindness. And we have to practice that constantly, do we not? To stay blind to reality. Had a very interesting dream last night. It just seems that I got it. There's no one getting it. I sort of accepted that there isn't anyone getting truth. There's no one to get truth. There's no one to get truth. There's no truth getter. We are the truth. This is what the non-dualists keep telling us. We just have to keep hearing it. There's no one getting the truth. The truth is always been unmistakably apparent. Inherent spaciousness is. We just realize, oh my gosh, it's. How could we ever have thought something could happen to that? It's impossible. You skip a stone across the water. What's happening to the rock's inherent spaciousness? The water's having ripples. What's happening to the water's inherent spaciousness? Nothing's happening to it. Satsang, you sit there quietly. So, you can go to Facebook and look at these pages and read the quotes, look at the pictures, read the quotes. Why not? These are the best websites I've found on the internet, actually. These timelines of all these pictures and quotes from these Dharma kings. It's like, wow. It's like every day there's more. And sometimes multiple postings per day. Sometimes 5 or 6 posts per day, and a lot of people comment on them. You can read the comments. A lot of Indians on the site. They have their way of commenting, and we might comment in a different way. I do. I wonder. That's really different. They say, Jaima! I call it Jaima. They call it Jaiba. Jaiba. I mean, victory to Ma. Of course, I wouldn't use the term like Ma like that, because she said, don't call me Ma. That's very wrong. I'm nobody's mother in that regard at all. She said that creates distance and awe and separation and all the stuff you don't want. It creates all these concepts. So, just see me as a friend. Little daughter or a friend, little child or something, or a friend. But they have their ways of just expressing gratitude. It's partly a cultural thing. So I have a different way of relating. I just pass on the message. Practice, practice, practice. Keep satsang, keep satsang, keep satsang. Practice, practice, practice. Okay. As Ramana said, you can sing the praises of the medicine all you want. If you don't take the medicine, it's not going to help you. It's right, it's true. You know, we're doing the mantra, 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 medicine, 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 this. He says, you got to take the medicine. Okay. If you want to get better, take the medicine. So we're into taking the medicine as far as full stop in the wow, ripening the fruit, and, you know, let it fall. Let the fruit fall. And let it fall where it may. If it happens to fall here, it falls here. Let the guru explain it. You know, I'm not pursuing any explanation because it's already fallen. What good is an explanation going to do me? People say, well, it'll do us good. We said, well, nobody explained to me, you know, when my fruit was going to fall. I just got to keep practicing. And when you're ready, it will fall. So don't worry about it. And that's just the ego worrying about it. Just keep working out. And again, a workout, an hour, like an hour. Most people who've done fitness, they think like an hour workout. Okay, work out for an hour on the spiritual workout, at least an hour, if you can. And then fill in 5 minutes here, 10 minutes here, 20 minutes here. This is how I do it a lot. I'll take 10 minutes. I'll take 20 minutes. I'll take an hour. I'll take two. And just throughout the day, you just pepper it with your attention. Pepper the day with your attention. If you got 5 minutes, give it 5 minutes. Give it 5 minutes. Give it 10. Before you go to bed, give it half an hour, right? I'll push it before I go to bed. If I don't have to get up real early, I'll say, you know, I'm going to just give it another hour or whatever. Just so make a big push before you go to bed as far as making sure that you've got your workout in for the day. And, you know, then leave the rest to the Dharma Kings. You do your workout and leave the rest to them. They have our backs. They know who's working out. They're not sacrificial Dharma Kings. Far from it. Don't worry about, you know, knowing. Well, I was talking with someone today. Just everything today was just wisdom, wisdom, wisdom. It was amazing. Amazing, amazing, amazing. Miraculous. Very miraculous. They understood what I was talking about, too. I said, look, I'm not going out playing golf or going to the driving range because I know what's going to result in a good swing, which is more fitness. And they said, yeah, you know, so you're not looking for magic on the driving range. I said, exactly right. Exactly right. This is exactly what we do. When we're not in shape, we'll go to the driving range. This is an example, just a physical example of a spiritual issue here. And we will hit ball after ball after ball and be searching for some magical grip adjustment, some elbow adjustment, you know, just some... Let me modify my stance a little bit and grip a little bit different. And we'll try. And what happens? You feel injured afterwards. You try too much because you never can quite find it. And you think, some magic is somewhere. Why do we do that? Because we're lazy and we're looking for magic. Same thing on the spiritual path. Everyone here in the world, they're very lazy. They look for magic. Which is arrogance will give you all sorts of magic to count on. And it'll fail you terribly. So, I just realized today, you know, the one thing I never tried was actually really trying to get in shape in terms of just keep working it and keep better and get really, really strong, flexible strength, and really just build it up. That's the magic. That's the secret. Like Ben Hogan used to say. They kept saying, Ben, you know, what's your secret? Like he has some grip or something like that.
Yeah, I'm good. Close it, please, yeah. Yeah, sure.
Got interrupted there for absolutely no reason. Really stupid. As always, you know, it's just, so, they were looking, Ben, a great golfer, Ben Hogan, he was just amazing, and everybody kept bugging him, you know, what's your secret, and he just said, look, you know, the secret's in the dirt, meaning, he's out there working on his game, and, you know, he's just insanely fit, insanely strong, and flexible, and just, you know, he's working out. In other words, now he worked out in his way, but the point is the same. Everybody's looking for a secret because they're lazy. They say, well, I don't have the time to, you know, work out like that, Ben. But if you could just share a little secret, a little tip, you know, give you a little tip, Ben. He says, there's no tip I can give you. It's the practice I'm putting in. It's the work I'm putting in is the secret. And this is the thing. No matter who you are, everybody in the world, they're going to look for the secret. What secret? Because they're lazy. They're not willing to put in the work. They're not desperate enough. And again, desperation is a great friend. It's the best friend we have. Make sure you feel desperate enough to do the work. Your house is on fire. You better, you know, get out of your house. Get out of the house that's on fire, so to speak. Don't worry about trivial nonsense when we're fleeing a fire. I mean, who does that except, you know, extremely arrogant fools worry about trivial stuff. Like today, I did a cleanup, did the best I could, some trivial stuff. Okay, whatever, it's trivial. Forget it. I got the gist of it. Just get the gist of it. Get out of the house. You're not worrying like, well, what about my, you know, little figurines? Or what about this? Oh, I got some about it. Now, how many did I guess are counting? You know, this is idiocy. This is extreme arrogance to think this way. Basically, they're trying to be as spiritually blind as possible, thinking that will save them. From what? The pursuit of what we already are? No, it just intensifies the pursuit. And we'll never experience what we are as long as we're pursuing it. So we don't succeed in dropping pursuit by pursuing it even more, so to speak. Spiritual blindness, pursuing spiritual blindness, we can work on evaporating our continuity fear. You could call that, it's not really a pursuit, but we're working at it. But pursuing spiritual blindness is, the magic says, no, I'll get lucky. You know, arrogance always relies on luck. It says, no, maybe I'll get lucky. You know, we have to rely on luck. The more the world is relying on luck, the more the arrogance and ego has control of the world. And as you see, like the United States, they used to ban gambling. It's up in Nevada, and it's everywhere now. It's just like a plague. Because more and more people are relying on luck. If there's nothing, luck has nothing to do with it. Nothing to do with it. The grace of the guru is not luck. It's that they have perfect discernment. And I don't have perfect discernment, so I can't really answer the question. You know, what did I do? I don't know. Well, let the gurus tell us when they want to tell us. Right now, they just say, just the grace of the guru, and leave it at that. Your house is on fire. You got to stay busy. It's not a time to you know, split hairs here at all. So, I'm not playing golf. I'm not going to a driving range. I'm not even hardly swinging the club at all. A few times just to see, and it's like, wow. I just say, that's enough. I don't need to see anymore. It's obviously working. Holy cow. But don't show off. Just keep working. Just get stronger. Keep working at it. It's working. The regimen I'm doing is working. And I've really, really, really worked at it. Just overall, 360 degrees, balance, you know, flexibility, strength, technique, just everything. You know, it's all there. And it just converges. And so, the secret is in putting in all the work. That's the secret. There's no other secret. I always say the secret is every day practice. Go after it every single day. Work on evaporating your continuity fear every single day. That's the secret. Everyday effort to evaporating our continuity fear is the secret. That's it. That's the secret. That is the secret. But nobody wants to do that. Hardly anyone. But what else could it be? I mean, of course that's the secret. And what else do we have to do here, actually? It's either that or be turned into a robot, basically. It's either that or, you know, or be burned down with the house. As the house burned down, you burn down with it. We had a neighbor that actually happened to. They moved from here, but I found out later, it was a friend of mine, really dear, a dear girl that grew up together. She died in the fire in the house, but didn't get out of the house, you know. Just like, wow. Pretty amazing. Don't go to bed drunk. You might have a fire in your house. You need to get out of the house. You don't want to be in a coma. So, desperation helps us. Shame helps us. I see like little Roy McIlroy hitting the ball, 350 in the air, and I'm ashamed. I look at the guy and I say, that's crazy. It looks like a wimp. I saw him, it looked like a wimp. And he's hitting it. I said, wow, how shameful. I can't even, you know, can't even approximate that. He's got me by 100 yards or more, you know, in the air. Wow, that's very shameful. So, you know, shame is a great thing. If you use it in a positive way, say, wow, I don't want to be this lousy, you know, don't want to be this lousy. What's the secret? You know, they start thinking, yeah, then that the golf magazines live off of people who are lazy. The whole equipment industry, something was telling me today that about the pharmaceutical industry, they're aware of, like, there's these vaccinate, you know, are these ways of preventing cancer of various sorts, and but the pharmaceutical companies are suppressing it. Well, you know, this big surprise, right? I mean, they've said that there'd been cars that could have been used, engines and stuff that were super efficient, but you know, car companies suppressed it. They bought up the patents and never see the light of day. And you think, so obviously the pharmaceutical companies are making trillions of dollars and going to make way more in the future, just unbelievable profits. Do you really think they want any of us in the world to find out how we can generally be well, actually be well? Well, answer is not in the slightest bit. That'll be a cold day in hell when they take that attitude. So you realize that there's a lot of pressure on us to be stupid. Pharmaceutical companies are putting massive pressure through the money. They're probably the number one supporter of the programming that you see on television, entertainment, and movies. Number one supporter of it, along with lawyers. They're big, and you know, beer companies, but pharmaceuticals are the number one behind the scenes in various ways. They have the money, they have the trillions of dollars, and they want everyone to be stupid. So stupid that they can't find out how to be well by using their mind. Okay, this is what terrifies them, that we might actually listen to Jesus and find out how he raised people from the dead, how he raised us from the dead. That's why Jesus scares the heck out of them. And they've been doing everything they can do to undermine Jesus Christ, as a matter of fact, through their magazines. You look at magazines and you easily can tell who's supporting the magazine advertising-wise. It's pharmaceutical companies. And you look at what's in the magazine, and this stuff is just designed to absolutely undermine your repentance, your willingness to repent. Because when you repent, you start understanding what Jesus has to say. You can see it and say, wow, I believe he's telling me the truth here. And Jesus healed everything and anything. Just walking by, just say his name, you're well. You know, actually, if you have faith, you know, it's all it takes, boom. had Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodro took away an affliction from me in 10 seconds. I said, okay, do your thing. Boom, gone. Do you really think the pharmaceutical companies and the stockholders, shareholders, everybody who's leeching off of that doesn't want to undermine all that wisdom and get rid of it? Of course they do. So of course their money is going into one direction and one direction only. That's to dumb us all down. Dumb us all down. They're probably the main culprit in the world. And this is what the Bible says, is that in the end times, the world will be dominated by the pharmacopoeia cartel. Be dominated by the pharmacopoeia cartel worldwide. And they will be the mischief makers, because they will sponsor a culture that is designed to dumb us down, and they have the money to do it. They absolutely have the money to do it. They bought all the doctors off. They take doctors on retreats and resorts and all these junkets and everything all the time. Just, you know, luxury resort hotels. Take 10 days and what, it's a seminar where they present their products to you. That's really a bribe to the doctors. I've had doctors tell me this. They say the pharmaceutical people are just terrible. I mean, they bribe everybody. Everybody's being bribed. It's true. It's true. They've gotten rid of Christian Science, haven't they? They really went after them, torpedoed them, changed the laws, made it basically, you know, felony to try to practice in that way. And so they're going to guard their profits in all ways possible. And that means that the culture will continue to present, you know, extreme dumbed-downness. How could it not? I mean, those who think that the world's... You get these people who pie in the sky saying, oh yeah, the world, peace and love and harmony and everything's coming. Really? Well, does that mean that all the pharmaceutical companies are decided to give up their profits? Because the only way you're going to have a happy world is if people aren't sick. Right? How can you be... The threat of sickness be hanging over the world? And all these, you know, everything you take has side effects, as our doctors tell us. How can you really be happy with the threat of all this kind of stuff hanging over you, and the pharmaceuticals come and say, don't worry, yeah, but there's a medicine, yeah, but it costs $1,000 per month. Oh, don't worry, with insurance, yeah, well, insurance costs, you know, more than $1,000 a month, you know, and they're not covering it all. Don't worry, you know, it's always don't worry. Who are these people that say, well, you know, pie in the sky, everything's going to be great? The trends are not that way at all. The trends are overwhelmingly to dumb us all down, so that we simply lose repentance, the mood of repentance, the vision of repentance. We lose it. That's the purpose. Absolutely. Absolutely it is. And that's not going anywhere. In fact, it's building way more now. Building and building and building and building and building. You think the pharmaceutical company wants the wisdom of the Tibetan masters to spread throughout the world and know how you know, all you got to do is tune into your spirit and any affliction vanishes. They want to bury that so that it never arises again in this world, so they can continue to make trillions and trillions and trillions and trillions of dollars and, you know, lavish it on material comforts and extravagances. And they want stability. They're stockholders. They want stability. Know that we can retire on this. You know, send our kids to college on the stock, you know, on the profits of the... So it's all blood money. It's all blood money. The whole world runs on blood money right now. Kids are sending our kids to college. Yeah, but where's the money coming from? You know, pharmaceutical profits, a lot of it, right? The culture, where's the, what's sustaining that? Pharmaceutical companies and the profits. The profits they make are just insane right now, right? Almost everybody's on drugs now. I'm not at all. Nothing. Not even an aspirin. Do you think they want that, everyone to be like that? Well, if they do, you know, we got a bridge to sell you. A bunch of bridges to sell you. This is just, you know, atrocious blindness by those who think the world is going in a good direction. Arrogance says the world's going in a great direction. You know, the millennium, peace, love, harmony, it's going to be great. That's arrogance will tell you that, because arrogance will have the world exactly where it wants it, which is nobody repenting at all. They say, well, I don't need to repent. I got this medicine. Yeah, well, guess what? The medicines cause problems, and you need more medicines to fix those problems, and then those cause more problems. And before you know it, you're on like 15 different types of medicine, and then one of them starts, causing too many problems. You got to shift to another, but it's 5 times more expensive. Oh, but you need a surgery for this cost. So just it's like a black hole. The medical industry is like a black hole right now. It's just sucking everybody into this black hole. Used to be, people just asked Jesus to heal them. Now, their faith wasn't perfect, right? But a lot of times, the healing did happen. And they said, well, let me strengthen my faith. Let me strengthen. Jesus said that there's no miracle that won't happen if you have faith. He said that mountain will move if you have just even the faith the size of a mustard seed. So he says, you worry about your health? I mean, if you have faith, there's nothing that can go wrong with your health, actually. Nothing at all. He said, your health will be absolutely perfect. Don't even have to think about the body. It'll function flawlessly if you simply truly repent and drop your arrogance. So the church, so there you have it. I mean, it's not getting better. It's going to get a lot worse. So you better be in shape. I've always warned people, got to be in spiritual shape, really good shape. Know how to practice. You have to know how to practice. Full stop in the wow, so you don't overdo it and you don't underdo it. It's like baking something. I mean, here's a good analogy for you homemakers. You're in the kitchen, you're baking something. You don't overbake it, you don't underbake it, right? You got to get it right in that middle spot. Baking a cake, a pie, whatever. If it's underdone, it's just, what's this? And if it's too much, people, wow, you overcooked it. So you get it just right, they'll say, ah, yeah, tastes great. Yeah, it's like cooking. If you're a good cook, many of us are, you got to get at the right moment, right? But there's a comfort zone in there. It's not like to the second, but there's a comfort zone in there. So your spiritual practice, just think like you're cooking up a great meal, and it just, you don't want to undercook it or overcook it. But it certainly has to be cooked. The wow, the burn has to be there. The wow has to be there. You've got to get to the wow. It's like if you don't get to the wow, you're not putting enough heat on the cake, and there's not enough heat in the oven. You gotta have enough heat to cook it. So we got to put enough heat on our practicing to bring the wow up. Okay, have to. And then you don't want to overdo it, then full stop on the wow. Turn the oven off for a while. Or, take the cake out of the oven maybe or something. You just back off and let it coast for a while. Just coast for a little bit. So there's all sorts of analogies you can relate. Anyone can find an analogy they can relate to with this practice. So being really good at this practice, I can do it. I can bake that cake. Whatever the cake is, I can bake it. Because I understand the principle. I understand the principle. So whatever the clarity is, I understand the principle. Okay, fine. Okay, so I can feel the heat. I can feel the burn. Okay, let's turn the heat off. You stop pushing things and just let the reverberation, the shock, reverberate. It's easy. But you have to get confidence in it. It's easy, but you need confidence. And you have to be decisive, and not start second guessing yourself. You say, okay, by watching a good cook, is aware, is in the kitchen, they're aware how long that cake's been in there. They check it, they're looking at it. So they don't just set a timer. I mean, they also check it. They set a timer, they also check it. Is it put a little something in it, they'll pull it out. Is anything sticking to it? I mean, they get the moisture just right. They're looking for the moisture, they're looking for stuff. So they're paying attention. So when we practice, when we're making assertions and flipping the script, we're aware and we're practicing. We're aware. Keep our attention right on it, right on it. We're not drifting off here or there, there, there. Our attention is, how do I feel? My attention is right here. And then when the burn starts arising, like, wow, I can feel it now. It's really, this is an intense shift of my expectations. The landscape, my expectations have just suddenly shifted. There's the wow, the earthquake has happened, the inner earthquake has happened. And so then you realize, okay, let everything settle down now. Very simple, but you have to be on it, you have to have confidence, and you cannot override your sensibilities through stimulants. You cannot do that. Or depressants, either one. Nothing to hype you up, nothing to calm you down too much, because you'll miss it then. You'll miss it. Either overdo it or underdo it. You got to get it just right. Just in the middle there. Middle path, as Buddha said, the middle path. The wow, you have to be very aware of this. Okay, very great. What have we done? We've gotten our hour in here, right? We've done it just right. Okay, very great. That's it for this one. Expect the unexpected now. Expect intensity now. Expect the Holy Spirit to get your attention. Okay, and just keep on working out. This is the secret. Take a satsang. Take a satsang. Take satsang.